हेलो एवरीवन एंड वेलकम बैक टू माय चैनल। आई होप यू ऑल आर डूइंग गुड ड्यूरिंग दिस चैलेंजिंग टाइम्स। सो इन द पास्ट टू लेक्चर्स वी हैव लुक्ड एट हाउ वी कैन राइट एन इम्प्लिसिट सॉल्वर फॉर अ प्योर डिफ्यूजन प्रोसेस। सो इफ यू हैवंट वॉच दोज टू वीडियोज प्लीज गो थ्रू दैट। आई पुट द लिंक अप हियर। द रीजन बींग बिकॉज टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट प्योर डिफ्यूजन विद द सोर्स एंड आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू स्पेंड अ होल लॉट ऑफ टाइम अबाउट द फॉर्मुलेशन ऑफ द problem from a theoretical perspective, because I have done that enough in the first part. I've literally spent half an hour trying to explain the matrix formulation process. So I'll rather show the modifications today that happens as a due to the fact when we introduce a source term into the process. So the problem that we are going to look at today would be that you can think of this in terms of a wall heat transfer. That suppose that this is some interior of some building where we have a temperature of 50 degrees Celsius, and this is an exterior where we have a temperature of 250 degrees centigrade, and this wall is primarily transporting heat in the normal direction to the wall, whereas this wall, you can take this of a very large cross-sectional area. So some of the properties that I'm taking for the demonstration is that the thickness is 5 centimeter, the thermal conductivity is 2.5 watt per meter Kelvin, and because of, let us say, some unknown processes, that this wall is generating a heat of 1500 kilowatt per meter cube, and the cross sectional area is 10 meter square. So you can see that the cross sectional area is much larger as compared to the thickness of the wall. So that is why we can say that the heat transfer could be modeled by a one dimensional process that is going normal to the wall. And here we have TA and TB as the boundaries temperature. So for this particular problem, the exact solution is given in this form over here, where this Q is synonymous to the heat generation rate. So in this kind of problem, there is a very minor tweak in the governing equation that we had discussed in the last two lectures. So we'll see how the formulation of finite volume method changes because of that, and what changes are there in the matrix that we form in order to solve the problems through the implicit methods. So it is quite interesting because the occurrence of source term is quite common in CFD or CHT problems. So I hope that this lecture would give you certain idea about that. So without wasting any further time, let's get started. So the governing equation for this particular scenario is the first derivative of the thermal gradient, that is kdT over dx plus Q equals to zero. And if we use the same finite volume mesh that we had considered in the previous lectures, that is, the boundary doesn't have a grid point itself, but we can construct a finite volume that would go around the boundary. And if I consider any general point I, with I minus 1 and I plus 1 as the surrounding coordinates, then the first step in the finite volume process is that we simply integrate the governing equation on that finite volume as equals to 0, so that the equation itself is 0, so the integral also would be 0. So I wouldn't go into the further details as to how to proceed from here. The idea is to take or to make use of the Gauss divergence theorem and then apply the vector dot product of the normal vector. So I have done this whole process in the first part of this implicit lecture series, and you might want to revisit that in order to further understand if you feel that you cannot correlate what I'm going to say next about this formulation. So what happens after we do that is that we get this Ka dt over dx evaluated at the east phase minus Ka dt over dx evaluated at the west phase. So this is the east phase and this is the west phase, and these are the thermal gradients on that, plus some Q bar into delta V. So what I've done is I've assumed that the Q remains constant over this particular, or you can think of Q bar as the average heat source or the average heat sink on this control volume, multiply by the delta V, that is the volume of that control volume. So we have already looked at how to tackle these terms. So we looked at the central differencing scheme or the piecewise differencing scheme, piecewise linear scheme, in order to look at the expression of these gradient terms. But to understand how to go about this term, we do what is called as a source term linearization. So according to that, what we do is we write this Q bar delta V as SU, some constant term, plus SP into TP. So what we are doing is we are trying to linearize the source term. So you can think of this being Y equals to, so this is Y equals to MX plus C, where M is SP, X is equivalent to TP, that is because the TP is the variable of our interest. So we are linearizing this source term expression in terms of this TP. And you can very well see that if we have a constant source like we have in this particular demo problem, then we have SP equals to 0. So then we'll only have the contribution from SU. So in order to further understand why we have done this, what are the implications, you can refer to the textbook of Suhas Patankar, that is the Numerical Heat Transfer and Fluid Flow. I have given the links in the description for your convenience. So those are affiliated links and they wouldn't charge you any extra money. But if you make any purchase using those links, it helps supporting this channel as well. So you can buy any kind of textbooks from there if you need that. So this kind of source term linearization is very important whenever we deal with the source term. And this is a very common practice in the CFD world in order to linearize these source term. So now let us look at how are the equations change after this particular linearization. So when I put this particular expression into the governing equation again, we can find that we can mold this equation that we had previously obtained in this particular expression. So previously we only had until this term here, that is APTP equals to AETE plus AWTW. Now we have this extra SU because of the source term. And a very small change happens in AP. Previously AP was AW plus AE. Now we have extra plus SPTP. So there would be a negative SP appearing in the AP expression. So for our problem, SP is not a problem because SP is zero, but this is a very general expression. So in order to understand how the matrix formulation would change, so I want to compare the coefficients that we had obtained, or rather the equations that we have obtained for the last part where we didn't have any source. So these are the set of equations for a 5 grid point scenario that we had discussed about in the last two lectures. And we had seen that for the all the interior points, there was nothing in the equation. We just had an APTP equals to AETE plus AWTW kind of equations. Whereas on the boundaries, we had some extra terms that we called as SUs in there. But here I've used a tilde sign so that I can tell you that this is because of the boundaries effect, and this is not in terms of a physical extra source. So both these first and five equation, they have this SU tilde to demo that these are actually the boundary contributions towards SU. So now if I convert these equations from a no source scenario to the scenario of a source, we simply add an extra SU in all these equations. So this is for even for the case where we have a constant source or a non-constant source. So all these equations, they would have an extra SU. And that is the only difference when it compares to the previous codes that we have looked. So what we have to do is we have to add this SU in all those coefficients that we had obtained in the last matrix formulation system. So let me go to the MATLAB and show you what happens in the code as to what really changes in the code. So now let us dive into the MATLAB world. So I have taken the code exactly from the pure diffusion code that we have looked before. I have defined all the properties that were mentioned in the demo problem. So I'm taking the example with 20 grid points. The domain length is 5 centimeter. Based on that, we can define the grid spacing and the spatial location for all the points. This is the thermal conductivity and this is the heat generation rate. The area is 10 meter square and we have the boundary conditions embedded in these two variables. I've defined an extra, or rather written some extra thing here, that is tick. that is TIC. So this is useful when you want to time your code as to how long your code takes. So what you do is at the start of your code you write tick, and at the end of your code you write talk. So it's like time input and time output. So time input clock, time output clock, and MATLAB just gives you an idea of how long does it take. So this is a good practice if you really are very concerned about, if you have a very CPU intensive code. So you can look at the performance of your code and you can do something to make it faster. So just trying to demo it here, so you can try to use it in your solvers as well. So after we arrived at this, after we initialized everything, we come at the formation of the matrix part. So this is very similar to the previous situation. The only thing that we have done differently is, so this is the interior grids, if you remember. So the C matrix remains as it is. The source num, which was 0 before, it has the element of Q times delta V. So remember, this SU is nothing but Q times delta V. So that's what I've done here. So we have taken Q, that is the generation rate, times the area, times the thickness, that is, or the grid spacing, that is, the A times H becomes the delta V for that particular control volume. And we add this Q into A into H in both the D, that is the source term for the interior, as well as the wall grid points, the wall boundary points. So previously we only had these contributions, that is 2KA by H into T for the left and the right boundary points, but now we are adding this Q into A into H. And that is the only change that I have to make with respect to the previous solver that we had written. And that is why it becomes very important that you look at the previous two videos before you looked at this one, in order to further understand or fully understand as to what is going on. So now if I run this code, so we know that the boundary temperatures are 50 and 250 degrees. And again, another important thing is that after the plotting, I have written this talk here. So tick at the first line wherever the code actually starts and talk towards the end, and in the command window I can see that it takes around 2 seconds or 2.7 seconds for the code to do all the processing. So the figure shows me that on the extreme left we have 50 degrees, that is this particular point here, and we have 250 here. Previously we had seen that a linear temperature distribution had existed, but now because of the presence of a source term, we are no more into a linear regime, and we see that somewhere within the domain the temperature actually goes beyond the boundary temperatures and we are going as high as 350 degrees. So that is something that is a physical significance of the source term, that somewhere in the domain your variable of interest could outcross the boundary temperatures or the boundary variables. So I hope that this little demonstration would give you an idea of how to incorporate the source variables. So if you have any questions, please feel free to write me on my email ID that has been shown somewhere on this channel already. I'm sure many of you would already be familiar with that. If not, I have put that down in the description, and you can also support this channel through the link shown in the descriptions as well. And most probably in the next few days we'll talk about the convection diffusion problems, and that would be another step in order to further understand how to use these implicit solvers. Until then, please take care of yourself. I'll see you in the next one. Bye bye.